The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported claims that its net zero targets are at serious risk if solar is not reinstated to the Home Energy Scotland grant and loan scheme.
Minister Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We recognise that solar power has an important role to play in decarbonising our energy supply and supporting a just transition to net zero. However, we cannot meet our climate targets without ending the use of polluting heating systems in our building and moving to cleaner heat alternatives in the context of the real terms cuts to the Scottish Government's capital funding, as well as drastic reductions in financial transactions. This change is necessary to ensure that available funds allocated are targeted at measures which best support the direct decarbonisation of heat in homes.
Sarah Boyack.
By ending a vital source of funding for homeowners for solar PVs and battery tech, the Scottish Government is disincentivising climate action, damaging the solar installation industry and negatively impacting on solar and storage supply chains in Scotland. So what impact has the Scottish Government assessed it will have on these vital green jobs, given the warnings from the sector about undermining certainty for Scottish businesses, jobs and supply chains?
Minister.
So while solar panels are a well-established technology, they're also a popular technology that has been voluntarily invested in by households. However, we are clear that we have to make sure that the limited funds that we have in the Scottish Government for decarbonisation and also for improving the heat in people's homes has to be directed at the types of heating which is affecting climate change, and that would be gas boilers. So we're investing it in heat pumps or having solar panels associated with heat pumps, not just solely on heat pumps itself. It is a popular technology, it is viable without government support, and we're continuing to engage with the solar industry on the proposed ambition to 4 to 6 gigawatts of solar by 2030.
Sarah Boyack.
Will the Minister not accept that the ability to install solar panels would for many Scottish households have been followed by the installation of heat pumps and storage systems, but this decision will make it too expensive for our constituents to take this vital action to reduce bills? So given the popularity of these products, will the Scottish Government reinstate this vital funding to tackle climate change, create jobs and bring people's energy bills down now?
Minister.
It's not a case of reinstating vital funding. It's a case of focusing that funding on the areas which is going to decarbonise household heat more. We have seen our capital transactions slashed. We've got our capital has been reduced in real terms by almost 9%. Now, if there's a Labour government that gets in and wants to reinstate the £28 billion for tackling climate change, we will gladly take the consequentials from that and we would look at this programme again. But until more money comes the Scottish Government's way, I'm afraid we have to make this very difficult decision.
Colin Beattie.
The Scottish Government's budget has seen capital transactions slashed. Would the Minister agree with me that the likely incoming Labour Government should commit to reversing these cuts to Scotland's budget to enable grant and loan schemes like this to flourish? Otherwise, this sector will continue to be affected by the impact of Westminster austerity.
Minister.
Well, I can't agree more with Colin Beattie. I've mentioned how much our capital budget has been reduced, and I've also mentioned that there was £28 billion pledged by the potentially incoming Labour government for tackling climate change, and that would have meant we would have more money associated with it. We've seen a 62% reduction in our financial transaction allocation since 2022-23, and combined this puts extreme pressure on these budgets, the programmes and the programmes that rely on them. And also, you cannot decarbonise energy in Scotland without significant investment, not just in Scottish systems, but in shared systems across the whole of the UK and reform of the UK energy markets. We're weeks away from a change in UK government. If Labour are concerned about the impact of these reductions on grants, then fine, they need to put their money where their mouth is and commit to immediately reversing the cuts that we've seen to our capital budget. And if they don't, it's clear that the austerity of the Tories will continue under Labour and its effect will be felt up and down the country.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This Scottish Government have consistently underestimated the impact that solar can have, especially in conjunction with wind power. Can I ask why on earth do we have buildings without solar panels on the roof when they take up no more room? Why don't we have every new home built with solar panels? And why don't we have local networks, for example, for car charging points, especially in rural areas which are off-grid? These are the things that we should be doing to support the move to green energy.
Minister.
Well, a number of the things that Brian Whittle mentions go across a whole range of government portfolios. He'll be aware of the pledge that there are to increase the amount of EV car chargers over the next couple of years, and that's, of course, with Fiona Hislop. But from our point of view, we have got twin challenges of fuel poverty and climate change. And in order to identify and focus the limited money that we have, we need to ensure that we're putting money to reduce fuel poverty. Incidentally, 150,000 households at risk of fuel poverty have been supported by Warmer Homes Scotland, which still exists, and they can still apply for solar. This is a particular Home Energy Scotland scheme where we're actually having to prioritise decarbonising existing heating sources.
Mark Ruskell.
The government's commitment to a solar target is welcome, but would the minister agree with me that it would be a missed opportunity if that target was only met through solar farms? Household solar battery and storage systems do cut bills, they cut electricity bills, they cut transport costs, they also enable householders to secure preferential electricity tariffs as well. So would the minister recognise that there are wider benefits here and commit to ensuring that loan funding is there for both solar PV and battery, even if it remains conditional on also decarbonising heating systems as a result?
Minister.
Yes, because I think it's a combination of having solar and heat pumps as well, and that's what this move has done. I would love to be in the situation of being able to give funding just for the installation of solar panels. That's what we started out doing. It would be terrific if I had the opportunity to reinstate that. But unfortunately, for all the reasons that I've mentioned around our capital budget, we don't have that luxury. When more money is forthcoming, if more money is forthcoming in our budget, allocation, then of course we can look at it again. But for now, it has to be a combination of heat pumps or low emissions heating and solar panels, not just solar panels. And I regret that that's the case, but that's the financial position that we're in.
Hugh MacArthur.
Thank you. Of course, it's I think difficult to square this cut with the government's stated intention to redouble efforts to meet our climate targets, having dumped the interim target for 2030. But can I raise the case of constituents of mine who applied for a grant for solar and battery supported by Orkney Renewables last year? Initially, they were told the application would be successful, but due to weather and other delays, the installation didn't take place until earlier this year. They've now been told they're not going to get the grant they were promised. I can write to the Minister with more details, but will she undertake to investigate the circumstances and ensure my constituents receive the support to which they are entitled?
Minister.
Mr. MacArthur, I will investigate that, because anyone that's actually had an allocation has 9 months in which to actually spend that money and get that heating put in place. So if he would write to me, I will investigate that particular situation that he mentions.
Question number two, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Premier Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde regarding dental provision in the Greenock and Inverclyde constituency.
Minister Jenny Minto.
The Scottish Government continues to work closely with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde to understand its plans for dental provision, including mitigations for practice closures. Current plans include a pilot within the Greenock and Inverclyde constituency to provide emergency dental services in Greenock Health Centre. In addition to targeted local action, Inverclyde also qualifies for national support schemes, such as the Scottish Dental Access Initiative, which pays out up to £100,000 for establishing, relocating or extending practices, and recruitment and retention allowances, which pay up to £37,500 to new dentists in the first 3 years of practice.
McMillan.
Thank the Minister for that reply, and the Minister will be aware that the dental practice My Dentist wrote to the thousands of patients last week to tell them that they will be closing on the 9th of August, and as per my email to you yesterday, Representing Officer, wanting to inform the Chamber this company is My Dental Practice. But this closure affects both private and NHS patients, but particularly NHS patients, because yesterday my office called every dental practice in Inverclyde and found that none are currently taking on any NHS patients, apart from one, which is taking on new NHS patients under 18. So can the Minister advise what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that my constituents have access to an NHS dentist, if that is what they choose?
Minister.
The Scottish Government is committed to maintaining access to NHS dentistry in Scotland, and our reformed fee structure has been designed to make continued delivery of NHS care more attractive to independent practices. Despite our significant reform, I acknowledge that access remains challenging in Greenock and Inverclyde, and therefore, as I set out to the member in my previous response, my officials are building closer working relationships with NHS boards, including Greater Glasgow and Clyde, on localised matters to ensure there are mitigating actions to support access to urgent and emergency dental care, while also supporting boards to be innovative and flexible.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank the Minister once again for that reply. And I, like many of my colleagues, have been raising issues regarding the dental sector for some time, especially since they have been exacerbated by the COVID pandemic. And these challenges are not exclusive to Scotland. And anecdotally, I understand that we, Scotland, are still in a better position than other parts of the UK. But however, we cannot be content with how things are at present. And I know the Scottish Government is working with the sector to make NHS dental work more desirable for practices and also to encourage more people into the profession. But nonetheless, can the Minister advise on the current model used to remunerate dentists who carry out NHS work? I know it's something, a point that was raised when the Minister visited the Weir McLafferty Dental practice in Gourock earlier on this year.
Minister.
Thank Stuart McMillan for his question, and I found my visit to Weir and McLaverty very informative and really re-emphasised to me the importance of having dentists on our high streets. Mr McMillan is also right to reference that this situation is not unique to Scotland, but we have a strong track record in recruiting dentists, with 57 dentists per 100,000 of our population compared to 42 in England, 46 in Wales. We delivered a significant intervention through the introduction of root and branch NHS dental payment reform on 1 November 2023. This preserves the activity-based payment which dentists are used to, but updated fee levels to ensure they are reflective of the increased costs of modern dentistry. In this way, we aim to provide longer-term sustainability and encourage the dental sector to increase its existing NHS provision. Our reform has been largely welcomed, well received by dentists, and I'm encouraged by the positive actions from the sector as they continue to get on with the job of providing NHS care to patients.
Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The exercise that Mr McMillan has just undertaken, I undertook 2 years ago, and dentists were not accepting new patients back then. I raised it with ministers and was promised that action would be taken. 2 years later, and you still can't access a dentist. And just if you're having been registered doesn't mean you can actually get an appointment either. The problem is, Presiding Officer, people in places like Inverclyde simply cannot afford to go private. So let me ask the Minister, when it comes to dentistry, why do people in my region have been given the unacceptable choice of go private or don't go at all?
Minister.
I thank Mr Green for his question. Payment reform, and I recognise this, payment reform is not the remedy to all to ensure the sustainability. We are also, as well as payment reform, the Scottish Government is also considering a range of workforce initiatives to improve recruitment and retention of dentists, including the direct access model, and utilising dental therapists to provide more NHS care. And this is something that Greater Glasgow and Clyde are very keen to be involved with. I and the CDO and his team are also working with the other UK nations to improve the overseas dental pipeline, which I hope will improve the ability to sustain dentistry in Scotland.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have to say the answers from the Minister thus far have been quite extraordinary. People in Inverclyde don't want warm words from this government, they don't want visits from the Minister, and they don't want comparisons with England. They want dental services that are going to be there to serve people who need them. And the reality is this is not the first practice to close in Inverclyde, and with remaining practices either closed to new NHS patients or dealing with ever-expanding waiting lists, the area is a dental desert. So I see the Cabinet Secretary's in his place, so he might want to reflect on this as well. Why has it taken so long for any intervention to come at all? And given that across the country, 4 in 5 practices aren't accepting new NHS patients, when Inverclyde residents ask who is responsible for the lack of dentistry provision they face, surely the only answer can be this SNP government.
Minister.
Thank Mr O'Kane for his question. And we have been working hard over the last year to ensure that we got the payment structures correct to ensure we have a sustainable dentistry. Unfortunately, Brexit has resulted in a reduction in the pipeline of dentists from overseas coming to Scotland and the rest of the UK, which is why I highlighted in one of my responses that I have been working cross-nation with the public health ministers in Wales, Northern Ireland and also in England to ensure that as we can work together as four nations to improve the pipeline of dentists coming into Scotland and also ensure that those that are practising in Scotland, dentists that are practising but are from overseas, can improve their access to sit the exams which allow them to practise full dentistry in Scotland.